We present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Jack D.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us this week in Shrewsbury, proud to be the county town of Shropshire. Opinions about how to pronounce the town's name differ in the north of the county. They tend to say Shrewsbury. To the south, it's known as Shrewsbury. Whilst in Wolverhampton, they say that poncy place full of toffee nice tosses. John Talbot, first Earl of Shrewsbury, died in 1453, and his heart is buried at the parish church of St Alkmund's in Whitchurch. An unpopular military leader, Talbot died at the Battle of Castillon near Bordeaux. After he was hit by an arrow, his men removed his heart and sent it back to England. Of course, if they'd removed the arrow in his foot instead, he might have survived. Shropshire is famous for its rich folklore. A favourite story is that of the magic princess who found a toad in her garden that was very sad because he was very ugly, so she granted him a wish. The toad's wish was to have a human body. So the princess kissed the toad, and sure enough, his body turned into human form, but not his head. So the princess offered him a second wish, and he said he wanted to be leader of the Brexit Party. Shrewsbury School is one of those public schools targeted for abolition under a Labour government, as they're deemed elitist. But Shrewsbury protests the school is open to any pupil who can pass the entrance exam. Question one, how many offshore investment funds does father have? Question two, list them using both sides of the paper. Sir Oswald Mosley was brought up near Market Drayton, became a Conservative MP, and in 1920 married Lady Cynthia Curzon. And during the marriage, Mosley conducted affairs with his wife's younger sister, Lady Alexandra, and with their mother, Marchioness Curzon. As an MP back then, this would have made Mosley the object of severe party disapproval. Today, it would make him Prime Minister. The Shropshire town of Ludlow was until recently a gastronomic centre, at one point boasting three Michelin-starred restaurants, although sadly it now has none. But Ludlow isn't alone in offering a disappointing lack of stars. Let's meet the teams. On my left, Miles Jupp and Pippa Evans. And on my right, Timbrook Taylor and Stephen Fry. And taking his place at the desk next to me to enjoy an evening of scoring, please welcome the ever-rippling Sven. Well, we start this week with a game featuring the titles of well-known songs. The county of Shropshire is home to many hugely successful rock bands. And T'Pau. Interestingly, the name T'Pau is taken from a Yorkshire Batman comic. The round's called Add an Adjective Songs, and in it, teams, I'd like you please to suggest some well-known songs whose meaning might be radically altered by the addition of a single adjective to the title. Tim, you could start.
The broken wind beneath my wings.
Miles.
Like a virgin train.
Pippa.
Always look on the bright side of life support.
Stephen.
God save the drag queen.
Papa's got a brand new colostomy bag.
Mary had a little roasted lamb.
Tell Laura I love her, sister.
The first time ever I saw your face lift.
Baby, it's cold outside the EU.
I believe I can fly, Tip.
The wind beneath my bingo wings.
Well, it's now the time when I ask our teams to sing one song to the tune of another. The town of Shrewsbury is synonymous with many giants of the music business. U2, Coldplay and Oasis have all passed by Shrewsbury on their way to Birmingham NEC. Providing the musical accompaniment for this round is Colin Sell. At the high... Is that your sister's in, Colin? At the height of his powers, Colin used to fill the Hollywood Bowl before brushing round twice with Mr. Hollywood's favourite pine-scented disinfectant. So, we'll start with you, Tim. I'd like you to sing the words of Common People by Pulp to the tune of Delilah.
She came from Greece, she had a thirst for knowledge. She studied sculpture at St. Martin's College. That's where I caught her eye. She told me that her dad was loaded. I said, in that case, I'll have a rum and Coca-Cola. She said, fine, and then in 30 seconds' time, she said, I want to live like common people. I want to do whatever common people do. Want to sleep with common people. I want to sleep with common people like you.
Thank you, Tim. Your turn now, Stephen. I'd like you to sing. I'd like you to sing the words of "London Bridge is Falling Down" to the tune of "In the Hall of the Mountain King" from Peer Gynt by Grieg.
London Bridge is falling down, falling down, falling down. London Bridge is falling down, my fair lady. Build it up with iron bars, iron bars, iron bars. Build it up with iron bars, my fair lady. Iron bars will rust away, rust away, rust away. Iron bars will rust away, my fair lady. Build it up with pins and needles, pins and needles, pins and needles. Build it up with pins and needles, my fair lady. Build it up with penny loaves, penny loaves, penny loaves. Build it up with penny loaves, my fair lady. Oh,
I'm so sorry.
Stephen Fry, thank you very much indeed, Stephen Fry.
So sad,
and quite a lot of you clapping along. It's always interesting to see who turned up in that coach that's parked outside. Miles Jupp, it's your turn now. I'd like you to sing the words of I toi puddy tat to the tune of Hallelujah by Leonard Cohen.
I am a little tiny bird, my name is Tweety Pie. I live inside my bird cage, hanging way up high. I like to swing upon my perch and sing my little song, but there's a cat that's after me and won't let me alone. I taught, put it down. Creeping up on me, I did, I toy putty cat. I am that great big bad old cat, Sylvester is my name. I only have one aim in life, and that is very plain. I want to catch that little bird and eat him right away. But every time that I get close to him, this is what he'll say. I taught, he put it down, creeping up on me. so I put it out.
And finally, Pippa Evans, I would like you to sing the words of The Laughing Policeman to the tune of Tina Turner's... To the tune of... Can you see it? To the... You watch it, Jack. Just because you've left your quiz.
I respect those who don't have the nerve to.
And finally, Pippa Evans, I'd like you to sing the words of The Laughing Policeman to the tune of Tina Turner's Simply the Best.
I know a fellow policeman, he's always on the street. A fat and jolly red-faced man, he really is a treat. He's too kind for a policeman, and he's never known to frown. And everyone says he's the happiest man in town. Ha 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 ha.
Sorry, that round usually goes a bit better than that. Well, the next round is all about making connections between words, and it's called Word for Word. Okay, so I'd like you to start exchanging totally unconnected words, Tim and Stephen. And Miles and Pippa, your job is to try to spot a connection. So off you go, please, Tim and Stephen.
Frog spawn.
Emancipate.
Well, there's been a challenge there from Pippa straight away.
Well, the frog spawn in many ways is the emancipation of the child from the mother.
Wow.
All right, yeah, keep
you're
it
right.
Light.
I
keep
should have thought
light.
Of that.
There is, yes, there's
there is okay, a connection.
Well, we'll
right.
give you that connection. I didn't understand it, but you can... over to Pippa and Miles to exchange unconnected words.
Marrow.
Feathers.
Pumpkin.
Balcony.
Paranoia.
Disease.
Stephen.
I think paranoia is a disease, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. How dare you?
It is. It's a bloody disease.
It's a mental illness.
We'll allow that. So back to you, Stephen and Tim.
Odd.
Torrent.
Oddly.
Lateral.
Oddment.
Marsupial.
Odder.
Incest.
Oddest.
Pippa?
I think incest is odd.
It depends where you come from, but yes.
Yeah, I'm from Norfolk.
I think I will allow that, Pippa. I think
Thank
you're quite
you.
Right. Miles Thank and Pippa?
Weasel.
Residual.
Peanut butter.
Cleft.
Stephen.
The cleft of your palate.
Yes.
Peanut butter always gets stuck in. It's the most notable thing about peanut butter,
it
really,
is.
Isn't it?
It's yeah. totally it's, true, that.
It is yep. true, that. I've often yeah. noticed it myself. So back to you. Back to you, Stephen and Tim.
Camel.
Throb.
Elephant.
Fleck.
Coax.
Stoma.
Portly.
Peremptory.
Pippa, again, you've...
So they both began with P. Does that count?
It's a 25-to-1 shot.
I don't think I can allow that.
Oh,
I don't
no,
think that's,
sorry.
That's proper. No, it's not. Don't apologise. It was, no, worth, a, no, it was worth a try.
It's worth
you've,
trying always,
You've lost
isn't
all
it?
The points you've won so far, but, you know. Back to you, Tim and Stephen.
Parsnip.
Normative.
Mustard.
Frilly.
Scallop.
Contingency.
Miles, scallop and contingency?
In my freezer, actually, I always keep some contingency scallops. You know, in case the gentleman doesn't come that week, you know, with his van.
The fisherman, the van.
You've got to have some contingency scallops.
Well, otherwise, you could be scallopless. It's a very personal connection that you've made.
I'm happy
there.
To talk about it. Happy to talk about it.
Now, if you keep contingency scallops and they're a thing, it's allowed. It's back to you. Back to you, Miles and Pippa.
Discotheque.
Raljex.
And the gong signifies that we have run out of goodwill. It's now time for a round that's all about those advertising trailers for TV and radio programmes entitled Trail of the Lonesome Pun. In modern Britain, the world of television has to cater for all creeds and faiths, and Channel 4 recently launched the spin-off series Naked Attraction Uncut, the non-Jewish version of the programme. The people whose job it is to come up with ideas for radio and TV shows can be remarkably lazy with their programme titles. So I'll ask the teams to share examples of programmes where the content has been contrived to suit what someone thought would make a clever title. So, Miles, can you start, please?
Later tonight on BBC at 9 o'clock, a documentary about the time that Parliament was disrupted by a runaway elk that later turned out to be promiscuous. That is... There's a moose loose about this hoose.
And Pippa.
At 7 p.m. tonight, tiny insects discuss fashion accessories. That's Fleabag on BBC Two.
Stephen.
Later on Radio 4, we explore a prominent psychologist's take on the phallic nature of London's tallest building. That's Schadenfreude, later on Radio 4.
Tim.
After the break, Ben Fogle travels to Australia to discover if there's any truth at all in the legend of the 20-foot crocodile roaming Darwin's sewers. That's Ben Fogle and the giant croc of shit after the break.
Later on Radio 4, Bear Grylls recounts the story of the large shrimp that accidentally attached itself to his private parts. That's Bear Grylls' prawn cocktail tonight.
And tomorrow on Radio 4, Spice Girl Melanie Chisholm asks, can owning a sheepdog cure depression? That's melancholy later on Radio 4.
Richard Hammond travels round Britain to celebrate our seaside towns. That's Top Pier.
And talking of piers, Piers Morgan and Katie Hopkins visit Oxford to examine the Reverend Spooner's passion for the repair and maintenance of the city's traditional watercraft. That's Care of Punts, coming soon.
Coming up this evening, Ben Fogle takes his fossil hammer to Dorset's Jurassic Coast on a hunt for the perfect ammonite. That's Cracking One Out with Ben Fogle. Later this evening.
Meanwhile, on BBC One, Charlie Dimmock takes command of a squad of Coldstream guards as they completely re-turf an entire rugby pitch in time for their crunch match against the Argyll and Sutherland Highlanders. That's sod this for a game of soldiers.
Well, the next round is the advice section of the programme, entitled Handy Hints, where the teams will attempt to provide solutions to listeners' queries. A lot of advice we're given today can be misleading. Only last week, I was following Jamie Oliver's recipe for monster muesli. After drizzling a dozen dates with agave syrup, the recipe told me to place your nuts under a tea towel and crush with a rolling pin. I did, and nearly fell off the worktop. Another nightmare is Delia's recipe for dinner party fruit salad, which says, I need pineapples 5 cubed. Where the hell does she think I'm going to get 125 pineapples? Anyway, teams, the listeners' questions I'll need your answers to are all related to the home and garden. When we've heard your responses, I'll compare them to the genuine answer each has received from an expert. The first one here is for you, Stephen. Mm-hmm. So can you answer this listener's question? It's very painful when my bacon spits at me from the frying pan. Is there any way I can avoid getting hurt when attempting to turn it with a fork?
Yes, you need a pole, a 6-foot pole, I would say. Give him the fork and then stand up.
That's good advice, but the advice given was cut an empty 2-litre Coca-Cola bottle in half and put your forearm inside the top half of the bottle. Insert the fork through the bottle spout and then you'll have the perfect defence against any hot fat which is spat at you. Here's one for you, Tim.
Right.
Can you help the listener for this one? Is there a good way to stop doors from slamming?
Stop telling people you're a Jehovah's Witness.
It says here, take a foot-long section of a foam swimming pool noodle and make a cut down the side. Slot the noodle over the top or side of the door and hey presto.
Sorry, that's what I meant to say.
Pippa. My undergarments require drying, but are too delicate to go in the tumble dryer. Any suggestions?
Well, you could avoid the problem completely by using a tenor lady.
It's actually use a salad spinner.
Oh.
Miles, how can I eat a bowl of cereal and avoid having to wash it up?
Add cyanide.
The answer here is put your cereal bowl inside a large transparent plastic bag and press the top of the bag into the bowl. Then pour your cereal and milk into the bag-lined bowl. And when you finish, turn the plastic bag inside out and recycle. Or just bloody wash up. OK, well, here are some for any of you to have a go at, please. How can I make bath time more fun?
Come and join me.
It says here, buy a bunch of glow sticks, put them in the bottom of the bath and switch off the lights. Behold, instant bath time disco. Well, what about this one? My child is beginning to doubt the existence of the tooth fairy. Is there anything I can do to rekindle her belief?
I'd recommend that you take all of her old teeth, which I'm sure you will have kept, and arrange them on her pillow to spell, I'm watching you.
It says the next time she loses a tooth, spray a £5 note with glitter hairspray and leave it under her pillow. How about this one? My wife and I love a fresh bunch of flowers in the kitchen each week, but find after a couple of days, the arrangement begins to wilt. Is there anything I can do to perk it up?
Polygamy.
It's amazing. He says, add a Viagra tablet. According to the British Medical Journal, Viagra can double the shelf life of cut flowers because Viagra contains nitric oxide, a chemical which not only slows down the dying process in plants but also causes a blood rush to the penis.
And does some plant food make you priapic? I was just wondering.
You could always try
it, alternative.
Yeah. It's an interesting question, yes.
I'll send you a photograph of the result.
I think we had agreed you weren't going to do that anymore.
Sorry, yeah, no. That's why you bought the second phone, yep.
And finally, my garden twine is forever getting in a tangle. Is there a simple way to ensure I don't spend ages looking for the end of the ball the next time I need some twine?
Cut the end off and then leave it in a safe place.
A It's meant to be, find a small biscuit tin and make a small hole in the top, put the ball in the tin and thread the end of the twine through the hole. Bingo. You haven't got a life anymore. It's very nearly the end of the show, but there is just time to fit in a quick round of Cricketers Film Club. Sven's been telling us about a formative first job he had working as a groundsman at the Oval. One day he was asked by a colleague if he fancied facing some balls after work. Sven says he knew for certain he was out after receiving a breathtaking full toss up the gasworks end. In this round, teams, I'd like you please to suggest titles of films likely to appeal to cricket fans. Tim, you could start.
Everything you wanted to know about Middlesex, but were afraid to ask.
Pippa.
Forrest Stump.
Stephen.
Hook.
Miles.
Underwood Milk.
Dirty Rotten Bouncers.
The good, the bad, and the googly.
Alistair Cook, the thief, his wife, an extra cover.
Dr. No Ball.
The magnificent 7 for 53.
Any film of Christian Bale's?
Angela's Ashes.
There's something about Marylebone Cricket Club.
Tendulkar is the night.
Interview with an umpire.
Star Wars, The Umpire Strikes Back.
Bring me the box of Alfredo Garcia.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the teenage tea leaf of time nabs the precious parcel of posterity that was left beside the wheelie bin of woe by the delinquent delivery driver of destiny, I notice it's the end of the show. So, from the teams, Sven, myself, and our audience here in Shrewsbury, it's goodbye. Goodbye.
Tim Brooke-Taylor, Miles Jupp, Pippa Evans and Stephen Fry were being given silly things to do by Jack D, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultants were Ian Pattinson and Fraser Steele, and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Jack D.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us on a second visit to the town of Shrewsbury in the fine county of Shropshire. Shrewsbury School was founded in 1552 and for centuries concentrated on the classics, but yeah, who needs Latin, hey? The town first became famous with the Battle of Shrewsbury in 1403, when King Henry Ivy... When King Henry fought a rebel army led by Harry Hotspur. The battle is notable as the first on English soil to have been decided by cannon fire. When the King's army famously met Hotspur's rebels in a field planted with peas, the battle was delayed due to confusion caused after Henry ordered his troops to shell them. Hidden away near here, the government has a top-secret intelligence listening station. Probably shouldn't broadcast that. It was there they discovered that Donald Trump's Twitter feed had been hacked by a 7-year-old when the standard of tweets suddenly improved. In 2011, they managed to identify where Osama bin Laden was hiding, as his compound had no telephone or internet connection. So, a BT broadband customer then. Abraham Darby built the first iron bridge in the world over the River Severn in 1781. So pleased were the locals, they renamed their town after it. Iron Bridge remains Shropshire's most popular tourist attraction, despite strong competition from the nearby town of Little Concrete Bus Shelter in the Dale. Iron Bridge is widely considered to be the birthplace of the British Industrial Revolution. James Wilkinson founded his steelworks there, originally manufacturing muskets and bayonets for the army, and then later making the vicar's machine gun, which must have livened up his sermons. The General Pharmaceutical Council is based in Shrewsbury, from where, according to their website, they deliver level 2 knowledge and experience-based dispensing pharmacy assistant qualifications, as well as accredited distance learning courses equivalent to the top-level MVQ in pharmacy service skills, which also require applicants to be employed on a practical training course in a working pharmacy for a minimum period of a year. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is where they learn how to disappear for half an hour, counting 12 tablets into a little brown bottle. But they're not alone in disappearing from public view for extended periods. Let's meet the teams. Please welcome, on my left, Miles Jupp and Pippa Evans. And on my right, Timbrook Taylor and Stephen Fry. And taking his place on the scoring desk next to me, please welcome our resident tree trunk in Trunks, the Immaculate Sven. Well, we start this week with some new additions to the Uxbridge English Dictionary. A good dictionary is essential for learning the correct use of similar words. For example, many people don't understand the difference in meaning between the words chav and prole. Well, chav is a pejorative and demeaning term for a working class youth, whereas prole is what chavs are put on when they're released from prison. But the meanings of words are constantly changing, teams. So your suggestions, please, of any new definitions you may have spotted recently. Pippa, you can start.
Abstainer, one who applies tanning cream to their stomach.
Tim.
Disposition, where I am right now. Exposition, where I was just then.
Miles.
Herbicide, to scrap a Volkswagen Beetle.
Stephen.
Heedless. Scottish decapitation.
Jetty. A bit like a jet.
Marbling. Mother's jewellery.
Gestate. Recently had lunch.
Brouhaha. An amusing teapot.
Fleetingly. To run away with a prickly sensation.
Debate. What you put on the hook to catch the fish.
Commandeer, a working-class woodland creature.
Biceps, to purchase porcini.
Baccarat, rodent that composed several hits in the 60s.
Artifact. Picasso painted 3,597 paintings.
Harmony, cash paid to comedians.
Chilcot, where a baby just relaxes.
Well, the next round, Censored Song, is all about the tricky subject of censorship. Censorship can take many forms, of course, from the government's redacted documents to Radio 4 Comedy's 11 a.m. Watershed. Ha ha ha! Many songs quite innocently cause inadvertent upset to the more sensitive listener. So, teams, I'd like you to perform censored versions of some much-loved classics, removing any smutty content with the aid of a buzzer. And piano accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell. Incidentally, Colin tells us that at a recent recital, he received as many as 7 curtain calls, all from his dry cleaner saying, "Your curtains are ready." Tim and Stephen, you can start, and I'd like you to censor a short medley of offending song lyrics. So off you go, please.
Oh, I do like to beside the seaside. Oh, I do like to beside the sea. Oh, I do like to stroll along the prom, 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 where the brass bands play tiddly um, pom, pom. So just let me beside the seaside. I'll myself with glee. And there's lots of girls beside. I should like to be side beside the seaside, beside the sea. A, you're adorable. B, you're so beautiful. C, you're a...
Thank you, Tim and Stephen. OK, your turn, Pippa and Miles. Would you please censor another selection of offending songs?
Maybe I didn't f*** you quite as often as I could have. Maybe I didn't you quite as good as I should have. If I made you feel second best, girl, I'm sorry I was blind. You were on my you were on my that's true, 'cause you f*** me, and baby, I f*** you. Babe.
I f*** you, babe. I f*** you, babe. I got flowers in the...
I got you, too. My ring. Put your little in my head. No, oh, we can't.
Babe. I you, babe.
Teams are going to do a spot of acting for us now in the round called Sound Charades. This is a variation of the old TV favourite Give Us a Clue, the show that featured my Master General, Lionel Blair. Yay. Sprightly veteran Lionel still enjoys world travel and recently visited Egypt's Valley of the Kings. However, disaster struck after Lionel drifted off during a guided tour of Ramesses III's burial chamber and was stolen by tomb robbers. On a happier note, Lionel is now on permanent display at the British Museum. T- Tim and Stephen, you're to start, please, and your title will shortly be displayed to the audience via the laser display screen. For listeners at home, here's the mystery voice.
Casualty. Casualty.
So off you go, please, Tim and Stephen.
So this is TV, isn't it?
TV, yeah. Yes. One word. One
just
word.
One. Just yeah, one.
Just the one.
Just the one. It's your job to get it from what we do
one.
Dramatically now.
Any other rules we need to know about before we commit?
It should all make itself pretty clear. I've laid out the Royal Doulton porcelain service in the green drawing room, m'lady.
Oh, no need for that, James. We'll have it in mugs.
Mugs? Ooh, very well, m'lady. Shall I require cook to prepare a pot of Earl Grey or the Maserati?
I should think builder's best will suffice.
Ooh, very good, m'lady. I shall send Mabel up with a plate of cucumber sandwiches, Patum Paperium on toast fingers, Abernethy scones with clotted Cornish cream and strawberry preserve, and a platter of dainties.
No, no, no. A small box of Kipling's and a packet of hobnobs. There'll be more than enough.
Oh, I see. Forgive me, m'lady. I assumed that this afternoon's gathering was to be a formal occasion.
Formal? Good gracious, no. Quite the opposite.
He's looking excited, Miles.
I am suddenly excited. I could tell it was tea related because I recognised several of the tea brands, and then it's Casualty.
Yeah.
Worth it just for the look of excitement on your face. When it was dawning on you. Okay, well, here's a final one being displayed for you, Miles and Pippa. And here once more is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
The Great Dictator. The Great Dictator.
So it's a film?
It's a film.
It's three words.
And it is a film old people watch. Excuse me?
Yes, madam?
The unusually shaped potato over there.
Yes, madam, but chance you mean the really rather enormous one?
Yes, it is huge. And, well, if you don't mind me saying, does it look like a penis to you?
It does indeed, madam. We even have a special name for it.
Well, I sure you do. Goodbye.
Thanks so much for coming.
Well, this is very interesting. How many words? Three words? A film?
And it's an old film.
Yes.
So, and it's potato features.
Big cock spud. That can't be right.
Why there was never a sequel to that, I can really understand.
I would have seen that, I know. I just
Goodbye, Mr. Chips.
The word potato is obviously not it. It is, isn't it? Sex Lives of the Potato Man is the only potato film I can think of. Murphy's King Edwards.
Imagine if you couldn't say the word potato very well.
Spud.
Puts.
Tater.
The Big Dictator. The Great Dictator. The Great Dictator.
You were so close, actually, when you said Big Cock Spud.
I was thinking along the right lines.
You were, you really were. I thought you were playing with us.
Say what you hear. Say what you hear.
Well, it's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. First, I notice our in tray is buckling under the weight of a letter. It comes from a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. She writes, "Dear Jenny Agata, why don't you call a midwife? Yours sincerely, Mrs. Trellis." Okay, teams, this week we'll be playing the version of the game familiar to poker enthusiasts called Shropshire Hold'em. As you'd expect, flushes count double, plus straights have preference, and queens are wild. I'll be a dealer, so we'll just shuffle the cards. There we are. Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So, Tim, you can start.
Queen's Way.
Mm-hmm.
OK. Okay, hang on. Well, I've... Oh, I can play Peckham Rye.
Peckham Rye, yes.
I can't really go. Can I have another card?
You can have another card, absolutely you can, yes.
Thank you.
I'm going to play Three of a Kind. I've got London Bridge, Putney Bridge and Upminster Bridge. Mm.
Three of a Kind. Well, that's good. It's worth knowing. I wonder what is actually... I don't know how much is in the pot, actually, now. That's... Oh. All right, Tim.
I appear to have Mrs. Bunn, the baker's wife. Are you sure? I'm sure these are the right cards.
Obviously, you can't play that, and as a forfeit, you're required to lose an item of clothing, please, Tim.
Okay. That's a handkerchief out of my pocket.
Gosh, they hold a lot of water.
Okay. Can I twist now?
I'd rather you didn't. Okay. So who's...
Right, it's me after Tim. Is Tim... right, then...
Are you putting your chips in, though, Mars?
Oh, yes, I am, yeah. Okay. That's very decent of you, thank you. Oh, well, I could... Can I put down the Veil of Health?
Yes.
I think I can declare four of a kind, then, because I can have Knightsbridge, Upminster Bridge, Putney Bridge and Queensgate, because you said queens are wild, yes?
Look, yes, that's right. Yep. The queens are wild. Well done, Stephen. Right.
I'll play Black Horse Road, and then I'll twist.
You want to twist?
Bollocks.
I began to flush, but that's only because of what she said.
But you are actually required to take off another item of clothing now. Yeah. Yeah. So it's just...
Go on.
Rubber. I wasn't right. Expecting that.
It's what you always ask for. So. Okay. Finchley Road.
Oh, Uno. Oh, no, sorry. Canada Water.
Canada Water?
Yeah, I could put that down on top of that, can I?
Yeah, you can do it. Yeah. That's good, yeah.
I can't do Old Compton Street because you said straights have preference. So, yeah, I'd have to do Kensington High Street.
Mornington Crescent.
Oh! Oh! Damn. Congratulations, Pippa. Well, the next round is all about reviews, both good and bad. A good review is something to be treasured, and after a recent performance of his one-man theatre show, Tim garnered this write-up. With material that strong, the audience knew they were in safe hands. And that was from the critic of Safety Curtain Monthly. In this round, teams, I shall present you each with a selection of genuine internet reviews, and your job is to correctly identify to what the review is referring. So, Tim, you can start. What is being reviewed here? They fly well until the feathers start dropping off.
Birds?
It was actually a review of goose feather shuttlecocks. Miles, this one's for you. Fast and accurate, but the result was a huge disappointment.
Is it a DIY paternity test?
You are actually right. It was a first response early result pregnancy test. Amazing, you actually got it right. Pippa, how about this? What is being reviewed here? Nicely made, but yet to see any interest from our stripy friends.
The new wing at Wandsworth.
In fact, it was Urban Solitary Bee House, again on Amazon. Oh. One for you, Stephen. What is this a review of? Not as arousing as the title would have you believe.
Is that Baden-Powell's Scouting for Boys?
No chance. In fact, the answer is the Big Book of Lesbian Horse Stories.
Oh. Not far off.
Okay, Tim, how about this? What's being reviewed here? It leaks and led to a very unhappy mum.
A budget condom.
It's actually for a breast pump. Miles, how about this one? Great till the air runs out.
Grandparents?
Inflatable sun lounger on Amazon. How about this one, Pippa? The look on people's faces when they come out of the loo is priceless.
Portaloo relocation service.
In fact, it was for non-tearing novelty toilet roll. Get on Amazon. How about this, Stephen? Disappointingly one-dimensional, but did come very quickly.
Yes, I'm sorry about that. We'll try again later.
It was a Boris Johnson cardboard mask. Well, look, here are one or two for any of you to have a go at. Comes with complimentary blindfold.
Top Gear DVD.
It's actually a faux foxtail butt plug. Not to be recommended. All right, what about this one? A good laugh during sex.
Penis wigs.
the answer was actually glow-in-the-dark condoms. Another reviewer writes, spot on for our Chernobyl role-play evening. How about this one? What's this a review for? Overpriced and underwhelming. They're mostly has-beens.
I'm sorry, I haven't a clue.
In fact, it was a review of Madame Tussauds as a TripAdvisor review. And this one, very effective. In 2 years, only one has managed to escape.
My anti-fart pants.
Well, you say that, Tim, but I'm sitting here. It was actually a review for Spider Catcher. And finally, does the job looks like a turd?
Anything from Ginsters? Actually, specifically the breakfast roll.
In fact, it's a review for a plastic turd. Another Amazon reviewer writes, item arrived loose in an envelope, so at first I thought it was a sick joke, until I remembered ordering it for the centrepiece of my wife's birthday cake. It's very nearly the end of the show, but there is just time to fit in a quick round entitled Funeral or Bedroom. Unorthodox funeral services are increasingly common these days, the most popular option being to have your ashes sent up in a rocket. And my next-door neighbour did exactly this for his old dad and says, if you're thinking of doing the same, there's actually very little local authority red tape involved. Just make sure you have an empty milk bottle handy and that he dies before bonfire night. In this round, teams, I'd like you to come up with examples of phrases likely to be overheard both at a funeral and also in the bedroom. Maybe you should start, Miles.
Thank you, Vicar. That was wonderful.
Tim.
Do you think you should be videoing this?
Pippa.
Well, that was upsetting.
Stephen.
I'm sorry, I know I wasn't invited.
Will there be sandwiches after?
Too soon. Too soon.
Well, he lasted longer than we thought he would.
He touched all of us in so many different ways.
Your dad's probably looking down on us right now.
So good of you to come.
Your brother would have enjoyed this.
Four men from the regiment are going to shoot over him as he goes down.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the terrible toupee of time is adjusted by the Michael Fabricant of fate before slipping from the polished pate of posterity, I notice it's the end of the show. So from the teams, Sven, myself and our audience here in Shrewsbury, it's goodbye. Goodbye.
Tim Brooke-Taylor, Miles Jupp, Pippa Evans and Stephen Fry were being given silly things to do by Jack D, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultants were Ian Pattinson and Fraser Steele, and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Jack D.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us this week on a visit to Portsmouth in the fine county of Hampshire. Found on the island of Portsea, Portsmouth is the UK's only island city with over 200,000 residents crammed into an area of just 9 square miles. The population of Portsmouth is officially the densest in the UK. Hey, what do Ofsted know? In 2015, Portsmouth staged an exhibition to mark the 200th anniversary of the end of the Napoleonic Wars. The project suffered a lack of funding, but European neighbours chipped in with exhibits. France sent Napoleon's uniforms, Spain contributed standards flown at the Battle of Corunna, while from Geneva came a Swiss flag, which was a big plus. Turn on us yet. Modern Portsmouth is policed by the Hampshire Constabulary, whose record of crime clear-up rates last year was the worst since they stopped bothering. The Olympic fencer Bob Anderson was born in Gosport, but Helsinki in 1952. He won 2 gold and 3 silver medals for his fencing skills, and gardens there still have some of the neatest lattice and picket work in Finland. Portsmouth is well known for its large number of antique and vintage shops. When a rare print of the first ever Superman comic turned up here, a local collector sold practically everything to buy it. His caravan, his beer mat collection, and his rare model railways. But he's still got one thing he can never part with, his virginity. Portsmouth-born William Hutton was a merchant seaman who's noted for surviving the sinking of the Titanic. Undaunted, Mr. Hutton continued to work on transatlantic liners, although he did take the precaution of changing his name to Mr. Women and Children First. As a result of his time spent in the icy waters, Hutton suffered from a weak heart and had to avoid all forms of excitement, so his doctor prescribed him a season ticket to Portsmouth FC. But Portsmouth aren't the only team here to play to near silence. Let's meet two more. They are on my right, Tim Brooke-Taylor and Tony Hawks. And on my left, Rachel Paris and Marcus Brigstock. Oh, what some of you might not know is that Rachel and Marcus are actually married to each other. Yes. Their wedding earlier this year was a typical showbiz celebrity event in that Tim wasn't invited. And taking her place at the desk next to me to enjoy an evening of scoring, please welcome the ever delightful Samantha. We start this week with a round called New Company Slogans. Choosing an appropriate name for a new business is essential for its future success. For example, how profitable would the Portsmouth Futon Centre have been if it had stuck with its original name, Japanese Torture Palette World? So in this round, teams, I'd like you please to suggest alternative slogans for well-known businesses or products. Tony, you can start.
Ryanair. Sod the lot of you.
Tim.
Tampax. We may not be number one, but we're up there.
Rachel.
Marks and Spencer's, when you're ready to wear the same pants as your mother.
Marcus.
Superdrug. As good as your dealer or your money back.
Wix. Our doors never close.
Kindle. Because every commuter has the right to read porn.
Radio 4. Still to come, memory loss, incontinence and death.
Travelodge. Because someone else booked it.
Range Rover. We'll get you through the terrain of South Kensington.
Mars. A Mars a day doubles what you weigh.
Moon Cup. Our cup runneth over occasionally, sorry.
Waterstones. We're not a bloody library.
Facebook. From the people who bought you Donald Trump.
It's now the time when I ask our teams to sing one song to the tune of another. The city of Portsmouth has produced many world-famous musicians, including Roger Hodgson, lead vocalist with Supertramp. To the uninitiated wanting to explore the music of Supertramp, don't. Providing piano accompaniment for this round is Colin Sell. Listeners often ask what Colin does when he's not entertaining people. Well, he provides piano accompaniment on I'm So Lovely Too. Okay, well, we'll... Okay, we'll start with you, Tim, please. I'd like you to sing the words of Me and Mrs. Jones by Billy Paul to the tune of La Donna e Mobile.
And Mrs. Jones, we got a thing going on. We both know that it's wrong, but it is much too strong to let it go now. We meet every day at the same cafe, 6:30 and no one. No, she'll be there, holding hands, making all kinds of plans while the jukebox plays our favourite songs. Me and Mrs. Jones. Got a thing going on. Olé!
Tim, it's your turn now, Marcus, and I'd like you to sing the words of Firestarter by The Prodigy to the tune of Just a Gigolo.
I'm the trouble starter, pumpkin instigator. I'm the fear addicted, danger illustrated. I'm a fire starter, the twisted fire starter. You're a fire starter, twisted fire starter. I'm a fire starter, a twisted fire starter. I'm a fire starter, a twisted fire starter. I'm the bitch you hate. infatuated. I'm the pain you tasted. I'm the one infected. Twisted animator, I'm the fire starter. You're the fire starter. I'm a fire starter.
Marcus, your turn now, Tony, and I'd like you to sing the words of I Shot the Sheriff by Bob Marley and the Wailers to the tune of There's No Business Like Show Business.
I shot the sheriff, but I did not shoot the deputy. I shot the sheriff, but I did not shoot the deputy. All around in my hometown, they're trying to track me down. They say they want to bring me in guilty for the killing of a deputy, for the life of a deputy. I say I shot the sheriff, but I swear it was in self-defense. I shot the sheriff, and they say it is a capital offense.
And finally, Rachel, I'd like you to sing the words of Postman Pat to the tune of You've Got a Friend.
Postman Pat, Postman Pat, Postman Pat and his black and white cat. Early in the morning, just as day is dawning, he picks up all the post bags in his van. Postman Pat, Postman Pat, Postman Pat and his black and white cat. All the birds are singing and the day is just beginning. Pat feels he's a really happy man. Everybody knows his bright red van. All his friends will smile as he waves to greet them. Maybe you can never be sure. Let us through your door, Postman Pat.
Well, it's now time for a round that's all about those advertising trailers for TV and radio programmes. British television makers are rightly lauded for the quality of their output, and only recently BBC Four aired a fascinating documentary on the history of HP Source. If you missed it, it's available on Ketchup. The people whose job it is to come up with ideas for radio and TV shows can be remarkably lazy with their program titles. So, teams, I'd like you to share examples of programs where the content has been contrived to suit what someone thought would make a clever title. So you can start, Marcus.
Coming up later, Guardian journalist Polly Toynbee talks about how she cleans her lavatory. That's Polly put the Dettol on after the news.
Tony.
Later on BBC Two, Danny Dyer visits a royal residence where he recalls a painful encounter with a zip fastener. That's Danny Dyer's Hampton Court.
Tim.
Coming up at 7:30, a new reality show. Celebrities dressed as rabbits ski downhill to be the first to reach their little wooden homes. That's Starsky and Hutch.
Rachel.
Coming up, Anne Widdicombe explores her own niche hairbrushing fetish. That's Anne Widdicombe, Willicombe with a comb.
Next on BBC Two, Prince Philip presents his guide to driving for the elderly in the Great British Break Off.
At 10:30 on BBC One, Jeremy Vine reports on the popularity of Viagra. That's Erection Night Special.
Now on ITV, The Rover's Return serves its first ever portion of American chicken in Chlorination Street.
And next on BBC One, Bianca shows Sharon the best solutions for thrush in EastEnders.
Tonight on BBC Four, a leading genealogist looks into whether legendary American entertainer Bob Hope really might have family roots in East Anglia. That's Norfolk and Hope tonight on BBC Four.
Now on Radio 4, we send Piers Morgan, Rod Little and Toby Young to a South Pacific atoll and listen to their every word. That's Desert Island Dicks on Radio 4.
The next game is called The Symptoms, and it's all about the world of medicine. Medicine is rarely out of the news, and recently St Thomas's Hospital in London made the front pages following the collapse of its homeopathic wing. A preliminary investigation by building inspectors suggests there may have been a problem with the concrete mix, 50 gallons of water to one teaspoon of cement. In this round, the teams will assume the role of doctors and patients suffering from an imaginary medical condition. So you can be our first patients, Rachel and Marcus, and the identity of your mystery medical condition is now being displayed to our theatre audience, while here at home is the mystery voice.
Rachel and Marcus think they're made of chocolate. Rachel and Marcus think they're made of chocolate.
So it's time for your appointment, Marcus and Rachel. You need to outline your symptoms to Drs. Tim and Tony, and they'll be awarded points based on how accurately they're able to diagnose your condition. So off you go.
Do come in, sit down.
Thank you.
What seems to be the problem?
Well, I'm a bit concerned about Marcus. He looks okay, but inside he's nuts.
Yes, and I'm very worried about Rachel. She finds it difficult to follow through on things. To be honest, she's a bit of a flake. Yeah. A drifter.
That is true. I do spend all my time in bars. Nothing excessive, though, just a glass and a half.
That's not your dress, is it?
No, it's Rose's. Is that your coat?
No, it's Terry's.
And I think that hat must be Stephen's.
Yes, it's Fry's. Are you wearing anything else that isn't yours?
Just these, they're Mars. Oh.
Mars Snickers. Well, go on then, give us a twirl.
Shh, whisper. I'm keeping it under wraps.
To be honest, I keep getting the munchies. I'm worried about putting on weight.
I've started shrinking. Each year I get smaller and smaller.
Billy, you'd never know it.
Yes, it's clever, isn't it?
You are terribly sweet.
Oh, you're melting my heart.
Well, I do have a bit of a soft centre.
Oh, Marcus.
Call me Wilhelm.
I thought you were Marcus.
Yes, but I was born Vil. Well, I think we've exhausted that topic. Doctor, can you possibly help us with whatever this is?
They think they're chocolate.
They think they're chocolate.
Yes. Oh. Yeah.
All right, well, your turn to be patients, Tim and Tony, and you've just been summoned into the surgery of Doctors Marcus and Rachel, and the identity of your mystery medical condition will now be displayed to the audience via the laser display board, while here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Tim and Tony think they're radios. Tim and Tony think they're radios.
So, off you go, please. Tim and Tony.
Good morning, Doctor.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning. Do have a seat. What's the problem?
I was hoping the reception would be a bit better than that.
They don't seem to be on the same wavelength at all.
They don't seem very switched on.
No, never mind. Go on, tell the doctor.
Just a minute.
Well, tell the doctor about the funny turn you had today.
In Parliament?
Yes. I was making a speech when I got this quote-unquote agonising pain in my feet.
In your toes?
No, the arches. I went to see my chiropractor yesterday.
Steve?
Right.
In the afternoon?
Yes. Your brother Robert has the same problem.
Robert, or Marjorie, as she is now.
Ah, yes. Your trans sister.
So, Doc, have you any idea what's wrong with us?
You think that you're turning into a radio?
Pretty much.
BBC Radio.
Right, well, the next round is all about reviews, both good and bad. A good notice is something to be treasured, and Tim tells us a recent performance of his one-man theatre show garnered this extremely positive review from a grateful punter during the interval. A very pleasing mixture of old favourites and new. I can heartily recommend the pick and mix. So in this round, teams, I shall present you each with a selection of genuine internet reviews, and your job is to correctly identify to what the review is referring. Okay, so Tim, you can start. Can you tell me what's being reviewed here? Arrived dirty and without the beard. Not happy.
Brian Blessed.
It was actually a Santa costume from Amazon. Tony, what's being reviewed here? What an absolute con. I certainly didn't get perfect balls. Might as well just use a spoon.
An intimate grooming razor.
It was actually self-heating ice cream scoop from Amazon. How about this one, Rachel? What's being reviewed here? Discarded after reading two chapters. I found this dated.
The Old Testament.
Actually, that was Lady Chatterley's lover, again on Amazon. Marcus, what's this review referring to? Good, but a little bit uncomfortable due to the polls that hold it up.
The Pride of Britain Building Awards.
It's actually the multicolour umbrella hat from Amazon. Tim. Back to you, Tim. What's this a review of? Left them in a free bowl of sweets. Trick or treat never went better.
Senecot laxative pills.
It's actually Blue Mouth Trick Sweets. Makes the mouth and teeth go blue from Amazon. Oh. Someone who's never thought of mouse traps. Tony, what about this one? I was sceptical, but after 9 days, they're almost all gone.
Christmas house guest repellent.
Almost. It was actually for anisole cream. On Amazon, sadly, another review reads, "This toothpaste tastes funny." My arse is minty fresh. Rachel, ripped on first use, very disappointed.
A guide to natural labour.
It was a review for a Santa costume on Amazon, in fact. And finally, Marcus, what's being reviewed here? Hooray! At last, I've got rid of the little shits.
Eaten.
The answer was actually Nitwit's all-in-one head lice solution on Amazon.
Close.
Yeah, close. Here is some for any of you to have a go at. Clearly not built for anyone over 5 feet tall. I was bent over throughout.
Eaten.
In fact, the answer is HMS Victory, Portsmouth. TripAdvisor. How about this? Disappointing. There was some blackness, but it just washed off.
Justin Trudeau's fancy dress costume.
It was actually a review for Blackface Prank Soap by Amazon. What's being reviewed here? One was fine, the other was tasteless.
This morning with Eamon and Ruth.
It was actually an Ocado review for avocados, a pack of two. People review avocados. That's what we've learned here tonight. How about this one? Perfect if passing.
Dignitas.
It was a review for the Swan Shopping Centre in Eastleigh. What about this one? Caused havoc in the pub. What a hoot.
Beer drinking owl.
It was a review for novelty smoke bombs. How about this one? Very effective. We found it works better if you put honey outside one entrance.
The Ann Summers Winnie the Pooh outfit.
It's a raid ant trap on Ocado. And finally, what's being reviewed here? Since she got this, my girlfriend has started marking her territory in a display of dominance.
Is it the vote?
It was actually the she-wee female urination device. Now see
similar.
The wee standing up, yeah. Well, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there is just time to fit in a quick round of Sext Down Songbook. Samantha has to nip out now as she's off to enjoy the HMS Victory experience. She says she's keen to go again, as on her last visit, she was amazed to learn how to take an 8-pounder through the porthole. This round, teams, I'd like you to suggest some sex-down titles of well-known romantic songs. So you can start this one, Marcus.
Je t'aime lions.
Tim.
You can leave your teeth in.
Tony.
When I think about you, I touch my shelf.
Rachel.
Moobs like Jagger.
Do you think I'm 60?
Nights in Prestatin.
Whoa, your sex is on this medical form.
Me and Corporal Jones.
If you want to be my mother.
You make me feel like a natural Mormon.
Can't help falling in, love.
She wore blue Velcro.
It started with a piss.
I just called to say I'm on the train.
What is this thing called, love?
I am sorry, Eileen. I'll help you find a cloth.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the tanked-up teenager of time locks himself inside the putrid portaloo of posterity before the fiendish festival-goers of fate upend it into the harrowing hedgerow of humiliation, I notice it's the end of the show. So, from the teams, Samantha, myself, and our audience here in Portsmouth, it's goodbye. Goodbye.
Timbra Taylor, Marcus Brigstock, Rachel Paris and Tony Hawkes who have been given silly things to do by Jack D, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultants were Ian Patterson and Fraser Steele, and the producer was John Naismith. I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Jack D.
Hello, and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us on a second visit to the city of Portsmouth. Before James II was deposed by the Glorious Revolution of 1688, William of Orange braved a stormy crossing from Holland to land here with an army. He marched his exhausted men a few miles north and fought the Battle of Eastleigh to win control of the town. And then rather wished he hadn't bothered. The city's long association with the Navy is apparent from its pub names, such as the Royal Ark, the Broadside Inn, the Trafalgar Tavern, and the Lord Nelson Arm. Hampshire's county town of Winchester is about 30 miles north of here. Winchester frequently comes top in surveys as the nicest English city to live in, but after Brexit-related concerns about imports from Europe, the town suffered essential food shortages, with shops being stripped bare by locals panic buying wild basil pesto. Winchester College is the exclusive public school founded by Edward VI. Our very own Tim Brooke Taylor attended Winchester College and recalls how in his first year exams, Tim got an A in science, a B in maths and a C in history. Sadly, it was a spelling test. BBC Radio has its digital communications department here. It's they who are responsible for trying to fix those problems on down-the-line discussions that plague the Today programme. And just this week, there was a lengthy delay on the line, marring a live interview with Harold Wilson. The alternative treatment and well-being expert, Linda Bennett, has premises here. A keen Francophile, when she thought she might take her clientele over the channel to a meditation centre in France, Bennett rang their tourist board and asked for the name of a famous French retreat. They said she'd have to be a lot more specific than that. One of the UK's largest IKEA stores opened in nearby Southampton in November 2009, when in the first month, 15,000 shoppers went through the entrance. In celebration of the 10th anniversary, IKEA let some of them out. Exactly a year ago, an IKEA-sponsored academy opened in Southampton. Their first Ofsted report noted that the kids do very few actual lessons at the IKEA school, as most of the day is taken up with assembly. Just a short ferry ride across the Solent is the Isle of Wight. Now, the last time we were here, there were complaints from the people of the Isle of Wight concerning the jokes that we did about them. So apologies, and we will do them a bit slower for you this time. But they're not alone in being a bit slow on the uptake when it comes to comedy. Let's meet the teams. Please welcome on my right, Tony Hawkes and Tim Brooke Taylor. And on my left, Rachel Paris and Marcus Brigstock. And taking his place on the scoring desk next to me, please welcome our resident tree trunk in trunks, the immaculate Sven. Well, we start this week with some new additions to the Uxbridge English Dictionary. A good dictionary is essential for learning the correct use of similar words. For example, many people don't know the difference in meaning of the words ratchet and wrench. Well, a wrench is a hand-operated metal tool commonly used to turn nuts and bolts, whereas ratchet is what I found in my dressing room kettle. Well, the meanings of words are constantly changing, teams, so your suggestions, please, of any new definitions you may have spotted recently. Rachel, you can start.
Hyperbolic. Extremely large testicle.
Tim.
Buttercup, get ready for an injection.
Marcus.
Arresting, a Jamaican bed.
Tony.
Unisex, what students are having when they should be studying.
Affable, not a whole cow.
Fleeting, Jamaican getaway car.
Misdirection, what happens when you can't find the Viagra?
Gloating, Jamaican torch.
There's more.
Bunting, Jamaican bread roll.
Gujarati, it's looky you like painting.
Deceive, what you use to drain the vegetables.
Brisket, fast-moving grumpy old man.
Ringtone, give me a call.
Treason, a Yorkshire explanation.
Dictator, a Piers Morgan-shaped spud.
OK, the teams are going to sing along to some well-known songs now in the round called Pick Up Song. Marcus Brigstocke once starred in the West End musical Barnum. It was the show that did for Marcus's musical theatre career... Sorry, I'll read that again. It was the show that did for Marcus's musical theatre career... No, apparently the sentence does end there. OK, teams. Sven will spin the discs. Each of you should sing along to your songs until Sven turns the music down. If, on its return, you're within a gnat's crotchet of the original, I'll be awarding points, and points mean a frankly desperate exercise in puerile self-congratulation. What do points mean?
Prizes!
Excitingly, this week's prize comes with its own royal warrant. It's this generous tin of Prince Andrew whitewash. Tim, I'd like you to start, and I'd like you to accompany the village people singing in the Navy.
Where can you find pleasure? Search the world for treasure. Learn science, technology. Where can you begin to make your dreams all come true? On the land or on the sea? Where can you learn to fly? Play in sports and ski and dive. Study oceanography. Sign off for the big band or sit in the grandstand when your team and others meet. In the Navy. Yes, you can sail the seven seas. In the Navy. Yes, you can put your mind at ease. In the Navy. Come on now, people, make a stand. In the Navy. In the Navy. In the Navy. Come on, protect the motherland. In the Navy.
In the Navy.
OK, so you're next, Marcus. I'd like you to accompany Jamaican rapper Sean Paul singing his hit single, Get Busy.
Shake that thing, miss. Can I gonna shake that thing, miss? Annabella, shake that thing. Yeah, Donna, Donna, Geordie and Rebecca. Woman, get busy. Just shake that booty non-stop. When a beat drop, just keep swinging it. Get jiggy, get crunk up, percolate. Anything you wanna call it. Oscillate your hip, but don't take pity. Me want to see you get live on a rhythm. When me ride and me lyrics, I provide electricity. Gal, nobody can tell you nothing. Can you don't know your destiny? Your sexy lady want par with us, in the car with us, and on a wall with us. In the club, they wanna flex with us, to get next with us, they can vex with us. From the day me born, jag, ignite me flame, gotta call me name, man, it's me fame. It's all good, girl, turn me on till the early morn. Let's get it on.
Get it on.
Let's get it on till the early morn.
Marcus Brigstocke there. I think we'll call that your Justin Trudeau moment, shall
yes.
we? You now, Rachel Paris, would
yes.
you please accompany Whitney Houston singing I Wanna Dance With Somebody?
Yes.
Clock strikes upon the hour and the sun begins to fade. Still enough time to figure out how to chase my blues away. I've done all right up till now. It's the light of day that shows me how. But when the night falls, my loneliness calls. Oh, I want to dance with somebody. I want to feel the heat with somebody. Yeah, I want to dance with somebody. With somebody who loves me. Oh, I
somebody.
Where's your Paris? Oh, good. Don't worry, we can make that sound perfectly all right in the edit, you know. Sound like it was in tune and everything, honestly. Seriously. And finally, would you, Tony Hawks, please accompany Justin Bieber and Luis Fonsi singing Despacito?
Despacito. Quiero respirar tu cuerpo despacito. Firma las paredes de tu laberinto. You serrate the cuerpo to the manuscrito. Quiero vivir en tu pelo, quiero ser tu ritmo. Quiero ser mi santa boca. Sugar is his favorito. Déjame sobre pasarte son de peligro. Hasta provocar tu grito. Déjame ni dar pelito. Si te invitan vos a tu dámelo, socavo tu tu sándalo. Si que tu puto tándalo, magneti dani dándalo. Sabe que te corre corazón de baba didi bom bom. Sabe digo tu gadiga tema daba bom bom. Vemba puede pagar tu toy socape casabe. Quiero que mo se me tenga papa de la sala. Yo no soy caprisa, vidi gata di piare. En perinelle entonces, porque me se me salte. Pasito, 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 pasito.
Tony Hawks there. Sadly, I've just heard that a pod of dolphins has stranded on the beach outside. Well, the teams are going to do a spot of acting for us now in the round called Sound Charades. This is a variation of the old TV favourite Give Us a Clue, the show that featured Mime Master General Lionel Blair. Sprightly history buff Lionel recently travelled to Tolland in Denmark, where he and his wife enjoyed a visit to the world's best-preserved Bronze Age fort. After a long day on his feet, Lionel took a well-deserved nap on the soft sphagnum moss of the peat bog. Thinking nothing of it, Mrs. Blair continued her tour and found herself in the gift shop, whilst Lionel awoke to find himself in a display case at the University of Copenhagen. Tim and Tony, you're to start, please, and your title will shortly be displayed to our theatre audience, while here at home is the mystery voice.
Dunkirk. Dunkirk.
Right, you're guessing this one, Rachel and Marcus. So off you go, please, Tim and Tony.
It's a film, and it's one word, and it goes like this. Do you still do that impression?
Of course. Here goes. Beam me up, Scotty.
Well, that's that one out of the way.
Beam me up, Scotty. Star Trek.
Star Trek.
Yeah.
Kirk.
Got it out the way.
Kirk. Kirk gone. Kirk left.
Start the other side of I'll Kirk.
Dunkirk!
Yes.
Good. Okay, your turn, Rachel and Marcus. Your title is now being exhibited on the laser display board. And here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Raising Arizona. Raising Arizona.
It's a film and it's two words.
Arthur. It's Arthur, isn't it?
Oh, Sharon, I hardly recognise you. What have you been doing with yourself all these years?
Well, you know that dog over there?
What, Harry?
Yeah, Harry. Well, I've only been bringing up the bloke he belongs to.
Oh. So, you've been bringing up the bloke Harry belongs to?
Indeed I have. He's my son.
Well, I never.
Cheerio.
Right, so, Harry...
I've been bringing up the bloke he belongs to.
Owner.
Well, you wouldn't say Harry owner, would you?
Arizona. Raising Arizona.
Raising Arizona. Well, the next game is called Judge Jack. and it's based on the arbitration-based reality show Judge Rinder. The show's light-hearted format has been sold around the world, from France, where it's known as Le Jugement, to Iran, where it's known as Death Without Trial. So in this round, I shall serve as the judge in a small claims court, with one team acting as the plaintiff and the other as the defendant. However, to complicate matters unnecessarily, each team must deliver their testimony, alternating one word at a time. So, Marcus Paris, I would like you to be the plaintiff, and you're accusing the defendant, Tony Brooke Taylor, of stealing from you. So, Marcus Paris, what do you have to say?
Well,
it
was
when
I
bought
the
new
speedboat
and
I
left
it
in
my
house
over
there
and
he
took
it.
I
am
furious
with
him.
He's
a
bastard.
Tony Brooke Taylor, in your defence, what do you have to say?
I
stand
by
everything
I
have
said
yesterday.
But
now
I
wish
to
say
something
more
interesting.
It
is
mine.
It
is
not
yours.
I
had
another
speedboat
before
that
might
confuse
you
because
it
is
yours.
So
you
say
that speedboat
is
yours,
but
it's
clearly
got
my
name
written
on
it. I
wrote
it
on
it
carefully
with
my
biro.
So is that right? Was the boat clearly marked with the name Marcus Paris written in biro on the side of it?
Certainly
not.
Marcus Paris is they're claiming that this isn't the case. You didn't write Marcus Paris on the side of the boat with a biro.
He
is
a
liar.
Tippex
has
been
used
with
care
to
remove
my
name,
Tippex. But that would have surely washed off in the water.
That's
a
silly
thing
to
say.
It's not silly. I'm the judge. I say I say that that would have washed off in the water.
Well,
look,
I
love
you.
That's as may be, but I'm trying to get to the bottom of this. I'm saying that the Tippex would have washed off, and also so would have the name Marcus Paris. Is that not the case?
Well,
biro
can
resist
water
if
you
cover
it
in
glue.
Ah, and did you cover it in glue?
No.
I say to you, Tony Brooke Taylor, that the speedboat clearly had the name Marcus Paris written on the side in biro, but you took it anyway.
No.
What
we
did
was
put
a
large
amount
of
glue
on
top
of
the
boat,
which
tipped
it
into
the
sea
and
killed
several
small
but
entertaining
dolphins.
I'm sorry, I'm going to stop you there. I get the uncomfortable feeling that you are making this up as you go along. Furthermore, that you took the boat from Marcus Paris. It's perfectly innocent speedboat owner. Have you anything further to say, Marcus Paris?
He
is
guilty
of
taking
my
boat
and
killing
my
dolphins.
But I've heard enough, and I find you, Tony Brooke Taylor, guilty of the theft of the speedboat. What do you have to say?
We
wish
to
apologise
for
any
injury
to
the
dolphins,
but
they
were
bloody
stupid.
Right, court adjourned. Oh. Well, it's now time for a quick round called Garden or Bedroom. When asked about the subject of gardens, legendary wit Oscar Wilde famously remarked, "Nope, I've got nothing on gardens." So, in this round, teams, I'd like you to come up with examples of phrases likely to be overheard both in the garden and in the bedroom. Tony, you can start.
Shall we put it in the back or the front?
Tim.
Have a sniff of this.
Rachel.
I'm a bit worried I've over-trimmed.
Marcus.
See if you can find the clematis.
I've just planted it in peat.
Do you know, I've been tending to these for a year and I've only just realised that they're artificial.
I have a man in twice a week.
You don't often see daisies out at this time of year.
I had a pair of tits in here last year, now it's just this very angry thrush.
Good, well, it's now time for the round called Swanee Kazoo. Yay! You may be surprised to learn that the great Leonard Bernstein once wrote something for the kazoo. He wrote, "No kazoo." So in this round, teams, I'd like you each to perform a duet which combines the ambrosial breeze of the Swanee whistle with the barnyard burp of the kazoo. At the piano, we have Colin Sell. Colin would like you to know he doesn't just provide piano accompaniment, but has worked across several disciplines. He even wrote the arrangements for The English Patient. Drop off at A&E, then leave in a corridor for 48 hours. Tim and Tony, you can start, and I'd like you to provide us with a rendition of Twist and Shout by the Beatles to feature Tony Hawks on the kazoo and Tim Brooke Taylor on the Swanee whistle. Tim and Tony. You now, Rachel and Marcus, I'd like you to provide us with a rendition of the James Bond theme to feature Marcus Brigstocke on the kazoo and Rachel Paris on the Swanee whistle. Marcus Brigstocke. Incidentally, if you'd like a framed photograph of Colin Sell, I'm told there's one in the skip outside his agent's office. Well, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there is just time to fit in a quick round of Nautical Film Club. Sven was telling us of his distinguished career on the high seas aboard the Royal Yacht Britannia, where he serviced a number of queens and experienced many a rough passage. He says he still has an abiding memory of his leaving party, clinging to a boy after being tossed overboard. In this round, teams, I'd like you please to suggest titles of films likely to prove popular with nautical folk. You can start this one, Rachel.
For a Few Dollars Mooring.
Tim.
There's Something About Mary Rose.
Marcus.
Rowboat Cop.
Tony.
Four Weddings and a Funnel.
Anchor Man.
Some Like It Yacht.
Oars.
Sailor, 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 spy.
Oars 2. Think you know where I'm going next.
Drowning Miss Daisy.
Seven Tides for Seven Rudders. Starring Howard Keel and Ethel Mermaid.
A star is bored. A star is... A star bored... A star bored is bored. A star is star bored.
Leave it, Rachel. And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the half-cooked turkey of time is contaminated by the salmonella of serendipity and the desperate diner of destiny confronts the toilet out-of-order sign of eternity, I notice it's the end of the show. So, from the teams, Sven, myself, and our audience here in Portsmouth, it's goodbye. Goodbye.
Timbra Taylor, Marcus Brigstock, Rachel Paris and Tony Hawkes were being given silly things to do by Jack D, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultants were Ian Pattinson and Fraser Steele, and the producer was John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Jack D.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us this week in historic Richmond. Proud to be the state capital of Virginia, the fifth largest producer of tobacco in the United States, the other Richmond is 3,000 miles away. Richmond's most famous tourist attraction is Hampton Court Palace. In 1527, a summit was arranged to increase the bond of friendship between Henry VIII and Francis I following the Anglo-French Treaty of 1514. The French king arrived by barge and the two exchanged gifts. Henry was given a suit of armour, which he declared performed perfectly, and Francis was presented with Henry's prized jousting horse, which he later said went very well with Béarnaise sauce and a side salad. Originally built for Thomas Wolsey in 1515, Hampton Court later passed to Henry VIII, who refurbished and expanded the palace before it was reopened amid great celebration on New Year's Eve in 1534. A grand bonfire was lit and the people of Richmond gathered at the gates, hoping to glimpse Henry's magnificent Hampton Court in the firelight. With King James I, Hampton Court became known for its apple orchard, the orangery, the maize, and in 1607, the vegetable plot, when Catholic anarchists tried to blow the palace up with 36 barrels of sprouts. Richmond Post Office is a fine Victorian heritage-listed building in Windsor Street. It originally had 20 counters, but now they only generally use 4, except at really busy times when they use 1. At The engineer who designed the classic Range Rover lived here. He passed away last year, having collapsed outside Waitrose diagonally across two parking bays. But he's surely not the last here to die awkwardly in public. Let's meet the teams. They are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Timbrook Taylor and Sandy Totsig. And taking her place at the desk next to me to enjoy an evening of scoring, please welcome the ever delightful Samantha. Well, we start this week with a round called Sponsored Songs. It's a shocking indictment of modern celebrities that they all have their price. Indeed, all it took was several million dollars and a trip to the deed poll office for one of the world's best actresses to become Reese Witherspoon's. And for an undisclosed fee, stalwart Hollywood tough guy Vin Diesel was happy to lend his name to Lidl's own house wine. So, in this round, teams, I'd like you please to suggest the titles of songs that have clearly benefited from commercial sponsorship. Barry, you can start.
Spam Enchanted Evening.
Tim.
Can you hear the drums, Fernando's?
Graham.
Febreze, a jolly good fellow.
Sandy.
Love Me Tinder.
For those in Persil on the sea.
I did it Subway.
Let it be.
Sill it, bang, bang.
As the way I like it.
Corn in the USA.
Baby, you can drive my car. BP, BP, yeah.
Kinky Boots, the chemist.
Time for a musical round now as I ask the teams to sing one song to the tune of another. In 2010, the International Primate Protection League used a re-release of the Goodies single, The Funky Gibbon, to fund its endangered species breeding program. Sadly, the campaign wasn't a success, and there are currently no breeding pairs of Goodies left in captivity. Horrible image that's left in my mind. Providing piano accompaniment for this round, we have Colin Sell. Colin's piano playing has even been used by advertisers. Indeed, his version of the Goldberg Variations by Bach in a recent TV commercial saw product sales rocket, which delighted the client, the Acme Piano Lid Lock Company. Okay, we'll start with you, Tim, and I'd like you to sing the words of the Hokey Cokey to the tune of the chorus of the Hebrew Slaves, Verdi's Nabucco.
You put your left arm in, your left arm out, in, out. You shake it all about. You do the hokey cokey and you turn around. That's what it's all about. Whoa ho, the hokey cokey. Whoa ho, the hokey cokey. Whoa ho, the hokey cokey. Knees bent, arms stretched, rah rah. You put your right arm in, your right arm out. In, out, in, out. You shake it all about. You do the hokey, hokey.
Thank you, Tim. Well, you now, Barry, and I'd like you to sing the words of the Marrow Song to the tune of I Whistle a Happy Tune.
Down the road there lives a man, I'd like you all to know. He grew a great big marrow for the local flower show. And when The story got around, they came from far and wide. And when the people saw the marrow, everybody cried. Oh, what a beauty, I've never seen one as big as that before. Oh, what a beauty, it must be 2 feet long or even more. It's such a lovely colour, and nice and round and fat. I never thought a marrow could grow as big as that. What a beauty!
Okay, your turn now, Sandy, and I'd like you to sing the words of Madonna's Hanky Panky to the tune of Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Some girls, they like candy, others like to grind. I'll settle for the back of your hand, somewhere on my behind. Treat me like I'm a bad girl, even when I'm being good to you. I don't want you to thank me, you can just spank me. Some guys like to sweet talk, and others they like to tease. Tie my hands behind my back. And ooh, I'm in ecstasy. Don't slobber me with kisses. I can get that from my sisters. Before I get too cranky, you better like hanky panky. Nothing like a good spanky. Don't take out your handkerchief.
And finally, Graham, I'd like you to sing the words of There's No One Quite Like Grandma, yeah, to the tune of Charles Aznavour's She.
Grandma, we love you, Grandma, we do. Though you may be far away, we think of you. There's no one quite like Grandma. And I know you will agree that she always is a friend to you, and she's a friend to me. There's no one quite like Grandma. She is there in times of need, before it's bedtime on her knee. To us a book she'll read. Grandma, we love you. Grandma, we do, though you may be far away, we think of you. And one day when we're older, we'll look back and say there's no one quite like Grandma.
Thank you, Graham. I was teleported back to one of those old-fashioned cocktail bars, you know, like the one in Shining. So the next round of Word for Word is all about making connections between words. Amazingly, anthropologists have discovered tribes in the Amazon which have no word for time, just like the landlord in Barry's Dream Pub. OK, I'd like you to start exchanging completely unconnected words, Tim and Sandy. And Barry and Graham, your job is to try to spot a connection. And if I uphold the challenge, I'll ask you to take over the task and so on. So off you go, please, Tim and Sandy.
Cucumber.
Beagle.
Toboggan.
Tupperware.
Marzipan.
Crystal.
Election.
Scrumptious.
Florentine.
Gobbledygook.
Poker.
Serendipity.
Humbug.
Winklepicker.
Crosspatch.
Grommet.
Graham.
Yes, Wallace is always a bit of a crosspatch, and Grommet doesn't like it.
Oh, that's very good. That's very good. Well, I mean, I would totally give them that. Yeah.
You're actually meant to defend yourself at some point. You actually want to win.
Sorry. English is my second language. I was worried I was going to run out.
So well spotted, Graham. It's over to you, Graham and Barry.
Really?
Yeah.
That was my word. Oh.
Yeah, Tim.
Hesitation.
Fastidious. Abacus. German. Ballistic.
Sandy.
It was a German, Werner von Braun, who invented the whole concept of being ballistic.
Mm. On his abacus.
Yeah, I think that was true.
Sandy quite rightly noted the challenge there. I was wondering if anyone was going to notice that. But so back to you, Sandy and Tim.
Fantasy.
Mucus. Oh. Oh.
Barry straight in with a challenge there on fantasy mucus.
Yeah. Well, mucus fantasy was a big hit song way back in the 60s. I remember the band who did it.
How did it go?
Mucus fantasy, yes.
How did it go, do you remember?
Yes. I had this mucus fantasy. Was running down on me.
Well, thank you. No, to Barry and Graham.
Geriatric. Oh.
And that gong means that I've just invented a new way of ending that round. Well, the next game is called The Symptoms, and in this round, the teams will assume the role of doctors and patients suffering from an obscure medical condition, and so you can be our first patients, Tim and Sandy. The identity of your mystery medical condition is now being displayed to the audience via the laser display screen, while here is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Tim and Sandy think they're the three wise men. Tim and Sandy think they're the three wise men.
So it's time for your appointment, Tim and Sandy. You must outline your symptoms to Doctors Barry and Graham, and they'll be awarded points based on how accurately they're able to diagnose your condition. So off you go, please.
Come in.
Thank you so much.
Sit down if you can.
Thank you. It's good of you to see us.
Well, for a start, our friend here has lost his voice.
So we two will have to speak for him.
We're all addicted to TripAdvisor.
Yeah, but we only ever go to places that have just one star.
Yeah.
We booked a place some years ago and completely filled it. They were turning people away, what with it being that busy time of year that didn't have a name yet.
Yeah. That's right. Lovely place it was, very nice donkey ride.
Oh,
I remember, that was nice.
Yeah. I used to panic about these trips, but now I'm a stable person.
Yeah. Somewhere else we like to visit is Brisbane Road in Leighton.
Yeah.
Footballers will understand that.
Yeah, I've no idea what that means. we're booking again, aren't we?
Oh, yes, we will.
Yeah, yeah, I think next time we might go Virgin Holidays.
Yeah. So that's basically it.
Yeah, but there's only two of you.
I think their friend is hiding behind that camel.
He's got the ump.
You probably think you're magi and three wise men.
We do, yeah.
Okay, very good. Your turn to be the patients, Barry and Graham, and you've just been summoned into the surgery of Doctors Tim and Sandy. And the identity of your mystery medical condition will now be displayed to the audience, while here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Barry and Graham think they're in a pantomime. Barry and Graham think they're in a pantomime.
So off you go, Barry and Graham.
Come in, do come in.
Thank you. Yes. Hello, hello. Yes.
No, don't touch us, just sit.
Yeah.
Well, it's always this time of year.
Oh, God, a bit weird in the winter.
Very weird, yeah. I mean, this time last year, I was dressed up as a woman.
I tried that too, yeah. But I had trouble with buttons.
Yes, yeah. But I don't feel right. I mean, this morning I felt grumpy.
Really? I felt happy.
Yeah. 5 to go. I mean, I'm worried about my career.
It's behind you.
Yeah, we had an awful lot of booze last night.
Oh, deafening.
Yeah. You can help us, can't you, Doc?
Oh, no, you can't.
You think you're in a pantomime.
Yes.
Well, this next game is called What's the Question? And it's all about questions. Tim's grandfather was notorious for asking difficult questions. It was he who repeatedly questioned the seaworthiness of the Titanic, even before it had begun its maiden voyage. And when no one listened, he just asked louder. In fact, he asked so loudly, he was eventually asked to leave the cinema. OK, I'll provide the answers to various questions and I'll ask the teams to suggest what they think the original question would have been. OK, so the first one's for you, Barry. Here's the answer. What's the question? Poppycock.
What do you call a streaker on November the 11th?
Good. Poppycock was actually which English word derives from the Dutch word meaning soft feces?
Oh, yeah. See.
Poppycock. Easier to spell than diarrhea. Tim, here's the answer. What's the question? The answer is clatterfart, nimble chops, and blabberer.
Name three political party leaders.
It's actually, can you list three words meaning chatterbox, right? One for you here, Sandy. The answer is contraceptives hidden in Nutella.
Is there an alternative to squirrel culling?
Well, do you know, Sandy, in fact, the real question was, how does Prince Charles want to reduce the grey squirrel population? And the answer is contraceptives in Nutella, right?
The man is a genius.
Yes, I would have thought it would just make it incredibly chewy. Finally, Graham. Here's the answer. What's the question? £32 million of Viagra per annum.
What's the cost of the upkeep of Nelson's Column?
It's actually, how much does the US military spend each year on Viagra? £30 million. Okay, here are some answers for any of you to have a go at. This is the answer. A sperm donor.
What is the most popular whale kebab?
In fact, the question was... The question was, what can't a redhead be in Denmark? Yes. Sperm donor, did you...
We have very strict rules about
it. Here's another answer, like the question. With a chicken.
How do you make roast chicken?
It's actually, how were rich Danes buried in the first century?
Mm. With a chicken.
Mm. Yeah, not the redheads, right? No.
Here's another answer. It rotates clockwise.
You say you have an unusual penis.
What's unusual about that?
In fact, the question was, what does Venus do that no other planet does? That's it, rotates clockwise. Good. And finally, 420 mime artists.
What is 420 times more annoying than a mime artist?
The actual question was, what did the mayor of Bogota use to shame traffic violators into driving better? Well, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there is just time to fit in a quick round of duck quotes. Fascinating and beloved creature, the duck can live for 5 to 10 years in the wild, 8 years in captivity, and about 45 minutes in Chinatown. As you'd expect of this game, our panellists have been paired with 4 variously talented performing ducks. So at my command, each panellist will encourage their duck to perform a popular quotation uttered by a well-known person. And opposing panellists will score points if they're able to identify either the quotation or the person who uttered it. Okay, so Tim, you're to start, please, and the name of the person who uttered your duck's quote will shortly be displayed to the audience via the laser display screen. And here is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill.
All right, Tim, so will you encourage your duck to deliver its quotation now, please?
Is it a bit of classical work?
Not classical, but it's not.
Is it a famous speech?
Yes.
Is it Winston Churchill?
How did you get that, Barry?
I don't know.
No. I mean, I didn't get it, and I got it written in front of me. All right. Okay, your turn, Sandy. And
yes.
The author of your duck's quote will now be displayed to the audience. And here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Julie Andrews. Julie Andrews.
Here we go.
Yeah, it's punching Julie.
It's a song.
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
It's a song, is it?
That was just an observation.
Dear.
I think you've got us beaten here.
I think you have,
yes,
yeah.
You have.
Yeah. Sandy?
Yeah, it's a famous quote by Julie Andrews. It's high on a hill was a lonely goat herd.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, that's kind.
Yeah.
It's your turn now, Barry.
Oh.
And the name of the person responsible for your duck's quote will now be displayed via the laser display board. And here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Bruce Forsyth. Bruce Forsyth.
This is a legend that spans the generations, this.
Nice to see you. To
see
you
nice.
Got it. Bruce Forsyth, of course. And finally, Graham, on the laser display board now, is the name of the person responsible for your duck's quote. Here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Neil Armstrong. Neil Armstrong.
So, Graham, if you would coax your duck into providing the quotation, please.
Is it Neil Armstrong?
Okay, any of your ducks have any further quotes they'd like to share with us?
I'm no good, I'll try again.
I can see trouble ahead.
Yes, so can I, but that's not going to be.
Okay,
I think
I think you might have to help us out.
It was Arnold Schwarzenegger. It was Hasta.
Is it sport?
Hasta la vista, baby.
Hasta la vista, baby.
When you've got the answer, you can stop guessing.
Yes. Have you changed your batteries, Baz?
You asked me that last night, didn't you?
Sadly, the answer was no.
But you're still charged.
And So, ladies and gentlemen, as the troublesome travellers of time are forcibly evicted from the village green of gentility before group purchasing the unprepossessing plot of posterity and collapsing the provincial house prices of happiness, I notice it's very nearly the end of the show. So from the team, Samantha, myself and our audience here in Richmond, it's goodbye. Goodbye.
Barry Cryer, Graham Garden, Timbrook Taylor and Sandy Toksvig will be given silly things to do by Jack D, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultants were Ian Pattinson and Fraser Steele, and the producer was John Naismith. We present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Jack D.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us on a second visit to the Richmond Theatre in the town of Richmond, in the fine West London borough of Richmond. Being so close to Heathrow Airport, the borough of Richmond is under the flight path of jet aircraft as they come into land. You'd think that at times the noise must be unbearable, but a local estate agent explained that because of modern technology... honestly, hardly ever notice it. Recently opened to the public, Myford Grange is a large Tudor manor house on the edge of Richmond Park, which was remodelled in the 1690s. The interior refurbishment was by Sir Christopher Wren, who left his trademark carvings of the small bird representing his name standing proudly on many oak beams. The highly unusual main entrance was designed by Sir Arthur Ramsbottom. Jim Kirkham, the founder of DFS, bought a mansion here. As a young, impoverished man with a wife to support, it was Kirkham who devised the sofa bed when he forgot their anniversary. In later life, when he'd become known as the Sofa King, Kirkham took a much younger bride. His new wife found he offered her no interest in the first year, so when he started to look old... and sagged in the middle, she drove him down the A3 and dumped him in a lay-by. The chess grandmaster, Murray Chandler, lived in nearby Twickenham. After he became Commonwealth champion in 1984, he was invited to attend the annual Buckingham Palace Commonwealth Garden Party. And when he was presented to the Queen, Chandler silently thought for a minute before picking her up and knocking over a black bishop. Let's meet the teams. Please welcome on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Timbrook Taylor and Sandy Toksvig. And taking his place on the scoring desk next to me, please welcome our resident tree trunk in trunks, the immaculate Sven. Well, we start this week with some new additions to the Uxbridge English Dictionary. A good dictionary is essential for learning the correct use of similar terms. For example, a surprising number of people are unable to distinguish the difference in meaning between the words ocelot and tiger. Well, an ocelot is a medium-sized wild cat with an orange-yellow coat marked with black stripes, whereas tiger is what Yorkshire mountaineers climb in Swiss Alps. But the meanings of words are constantly changing, team, so your suggestions, please, of any new definitions you may have spotted recently. Graham, you can start.
Perspex, glasses for cats.
Tim.
Weeping, the sound of a very small microwave.
Sandy.
Limelight, a sugar-free lime.
Barry?
Tampon, Yorkshire for loudspeakers working.
Forlorn, suitable for use on grass.
Bittersweet, one armchair.
Tissue, Yorkshire kids.
Shamrock, air guitar.
Dildo, herbal bread mix.
Dim sum, turn the lights down a bit.
Orchestral, an alternative bird of prey.
Borneo, what they say in Italian maternity wards.
Well, the teams are going to do a spot of acting for us now in the round called Sound Charades. This is a variation of the old TV favourite, Give Us a Clue, the show that featured Mime Master General Lionel Blair. Sprightly 90-year-old Lionel thought his song and dance days were over until last month when his agent took a surprise call from Cameron McIntosh with the offer of the lead in a brand new production, Mother Teresa the Musical. Tim and Sandy, you're to start, please, and your title will shortly be displayed to the audience via the laser display screen. And for listeners at home, here's the mystery voice.
Mississippi Burning. Mississippi Burning.
Right, so you're guessing this one, Barry and Graham. So off you go, please, Tim and Sandy.
It's a film, and it's two words, and it goes like this.
Excuse me, Mr. Ippy?
Yes.
I'm sorry to bother you. I live three doors down. I just put the washing out, and there's a lot of smoke drifting over from your garden.
Oh, I do apologise. My wife's just lit a bonfire. Leave it with me. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Name Ippy there.
Yes.
Mississippi.
Yes.
Over to you, Graham.
We wonder, what is Mississippi burning? Yes.
All right, your turn, Barry and Graham, and your title is now being exhibited on the laser display board, and here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
The Crown. The Crown.
TV series. Yep. Two words.
It goes like this.
Open wide, ma'am. Ah, yes. I can see this molar has been giving you some trouble. What do I do? I'm a dentist, ma'am. We'll soon have this one out. Have I been waiting long? No, ma'am, but I'm afraid you may have to wait a while for a replacement tooth. Well, we'll have to get the Archbishop of Canterbury to put it on for you.
Well, I mean, that was extraordinary. It was like Her Majesty was in the room.
It was.
It's The Crown.
Well, it says here, that round went so well, let's try another one. We'll have another title for Tim and Sandy, and here is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Crossing Continents. Crossing Continents.
This is a radio programme, and it's two words.
What's it called?
So I so nearly fell for that.
Say, I'm furious.
Yes, and I'm pretty livid too.
I purchased these anti-leakage triple protection comfort pads. In all good faith, and can assure you that it is neither comfortable nor watertight.
I've had very similar problems. These so-called discreet and super-absorbent premium briefs are about as porous as sheet glass. The slightest giggle sets me off. Luckily, I'm listening exclusively to Radio 4's 6:30 comedy output at the moment. So I'm mercifully dry as a bone. But I'm still very annoyed.
And I, too, am thoroughly aggrieved.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Well, they both sound very cross.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
And
oh, that just cross.
Go on, Baz, you tell them.
Cross incontinence.
Okay, final title is being displayed for you, Barry and Graham, and here once more is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Deep Impact. Deep Impact.
It's a film and it's two words.
Two words.
Dougal!
Hamish, Hamish, you'll have had your tea.
No time for tea just now.
Well, look at you all smartly tunned out.
Well, I'm on my way to Balmoral for the royal picnic on the banks of the River Dee.
Oh, do the royal family know about this?
They invited me. Oh. I'm doing a wee dance while accompanying myself on the bagpipes.
Oh, a Highland fling.
Aye, while wearing my Highland bling.
Well, I didn't want to comment, but I've never seen so much gold and jewellery.
I have pimped my kilt.
Oh, yes. It's encrusted with gemstones and mink. I've never seen such a fur-trimmed cluster.
Oh. Oh. Oh, has it ridden up again? But, no, look at this.
What?
I have also pimped my sporran.
Oh, it must weigh a ton with all that precious metal, and you've pimped your bonnet too.
A 3-foot feather and mint rhinestone decoration.
Well, so summarise then. If I may, on the banks of the River Dee, in your pimped Highland costume, you'll be doing your turn.
I will.
And what do you call it?
I would have thought that was obvious. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
All I know is that the words fur-trimmed cluster will never leave me.
Dee.
Banks of the River Dee.
What was the term they used?
Pimped.
Yes.
Deep pimp.
Pimped.
And he's going to be doing his
turn. Pimpty turn. Pimpty turn.
Another word for turn.
Act.
Yes. Yeah.
Pimpty act.
All the right notes, but not necessarily not in the right notes.
De act a pimped.
De pimped, de pimped.
You're all. Time out. Should we put them out of their misery?
Yeah.
Yes, it was Deep Impact.
I've never heard of
never,
it.
Never. No, why?
I haven't been to the picture since Bambi. That's hilarious.
Oh, dear. It's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. First I notice our in tray has been bombarded by a letter. And it comes from a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. She writes, "Dear Compare the Market, I know who your insurance adverts appeal to. Simples. Yours sincerely, Mrs. Trellis." OK, on with the game teams, and in a bid to speed things up, I've provided you each with the latest satellite navigation technology. So if you please program into your sat-nav applications a route from Richmond Station to Mornington Crescent, taking account of Montague's Loop and avoiding Nip, obviously. I'd like you to start, please, Graham.
Right, let's see.
After 200 yards, turn left.
Oh, that's relatively easy. I think that will take me eventually to Oxford Circus.
Oh, very good.
Mm. Oh, boy.
Okay, well, I'll ask now.
Turn right in 50 yards. No, you're right.
Pimlico.
Oh. Pimlico? Mm.
That's what I said.
Yeah. hang on, I'll ask.
Take the Victoria line. I like the colour.
Chelsea.
Mm. Oh, very good.
Okay, that's... Yeah. I'm probably going to need a bit of help here.
Take the A3 towards Guildford. No, only joking.
I'm going to head west. I'm going to loop round to Boston Manor. Not my first time, you know.
Right.
Warning, old people crossing.
I think my best...
Still crossing. Yeah.
My best bet is to explore the diagonal.
Still crossing. Yes.
Arnus Grove.
No, I don't think so, Graham. No,
was that Nip?
Wait a minute.
Not Nip, darling.
In fact, technically, Sandy went west, which means that we, obviously, being here, we have to play the East Sheen Protocol.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a bit like the Richmond Protocol, yeah. But not as expensive. have another go, Graham.
Have to go right up into...
You are approaching the congestion zone. Apply decongestant.
we'll go to the Leicester Square.
Leicester Square.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Oh, dear. I was stuck in traffic.
It's not traffic. You are in a McDonald's drive-thru.
Euston Road.
Mm.
Euston Road.
Yes.
You can do that.
Oh, wait a minute.
Get in the right-hand lane.
Oh, dear.
It's 8 items or less.
Trafalgar Square.
Wow.
Mm. Wow, yes. Yeah.
Okay, that...
An expected item in bagging area.
I think from there there's... Well, I don't think there's anywhere to go. Can I go Parsons Green?
You can.
Yeah? Yeah, I'm going to go Parsons Green.
Oh, Parsons Green, yes.
Green, oh, right.
Recalculating. Sandy, you're being paid half as much as Colin Sell.
Parsons Green. I better go to King's Cross in that case.
Yep.
You bastard, that was going to be my move.
You're absolutely right. So,
don't forget your the Petersham rule now, please.
No, I won't, no.
Have you ever considered changing your electricity supplier?
That's not very helpful. I'll go for Platt's Lane.
Platt's Lane? And
I think I've got them.
That's bold. Mm.
There's a... somebody coming up behind me. Hang on, I'll just have to consult.
It's only a police car. Overtake him.
Okay. Wood Green.
Are you sure?
You have reached your destination.
Mornington Crescent!
Well played, Sandy. Well played, Sandy. Well, the next game is called Complete Christmas Cards. Of course, it wouldn't be Christmas without the release of a poignant charity single. Over the years, we've seen the release of some very touching Christmas number ones, though it's the release of the Boxing Day number two that really brings a tear to the eye. Okay, teams. Okay, well, in this round, teams, I'll read out some incomplete verses taken from genuine Christmas cards, and your job is to try to guess how the original verse might have been completed. So maybe you could start this. Barry, can you complete this Christmas card greeting? Yeah. The donkeys in the stable, the camels wise men bring, the sheep follow their shepherds, and...
Here I come with a shovel.
Then the Christmas bells do ring.
Oh,
Tim, how about this one? Mince pies and mulled wine, sausage rolls and cheese. It's the season to stop dieting and to eat what you please. A slice of cake and chocolates all go down a treat.
And type 2 diabetes will make your life complete.
And then goes on to, and then maybe in the new year you'll be watching what you eat.
Oh, cool.
does.
Sandy, here's one for you to finish. Do I hear a tapping at my door? Why, yes, it's...
someone trying to get in.
Is that she? Why, yes, it's carol singers collecting for the poor. Graham, happy Christmas to a dog. Happy Christmas, my dear little friend. I have filled you a stocking too.
With a cat.
you've got a bone and doggy chocks with lots of love from me to you. Yes, you live on your own, that's what happens. Back to you, Tim. Can you complete this Christmas card message? You've decked the hall with festive cheer and laid out all the goodies.
Complete collection of digitally remastered episodes, now available on DVD.
It actually goes the turkey roast with cranberry sauce, the Christmas puds and cookies. Another one, Barry, here's another one for you to complete. The very dearest man that you could ever meet delivers all the presents to each and every street. I'm surprised he never grumbles at the work he has to do.
That's what working for Amazon does for you.
It's actually... But he knows that every child on earth waits as he passes through. All right, Sandy, another one for you. This Christmas will be different. There'll be an empty chair, one fewer at the table, our festive meal to share. But Dad would never want us to be miserable and blue.
So what the hell? Let's sell his chair and buy more liquor too.
Yes, so let's make sure we celebrate like he always used to do. Graham, another one for you. Although the miles are many and our meetings very few, this card is sent to tell you...
I've not forgiven you.
It says that I miss you all year through. Another one for you, Tim, to finish this one. This little festive robin, so bright for all to see, is...
dead.
Oh, dear. Is saying Merry Christmas as you gather round the tree. A bit nicer, isn't it? Barry, how about this one?
Yes.
Santa is coming with his bulging sack pulled through the night... Sorry, Barry, I'll start that again.
Yes, please.
Santa is coming with his bulging sack pulled through the night by...
someone he met online.
It's actually pulled through the night by his reindeer pack. Sandy. Christmas time will soon be here. It's time to wrap the parcels.
Gifts for all the cousins. Dear God, they're all such arseholes.
Let's eat and drink and feast ourselves like kings inside our castles. Oh, good, there are some more. And finally, Graham, with your round, jolly face and your rosy red cheeks...
you really enjoyed that spanking, didn't you?
It's actually, you drive your sleigh through the town and the streets. Well, here are some for any of you to ever go out quickly, right? Let the bells ring out for Christmas, send their message loud and clear. Let peace and hope live in our hearts today and all the year. Let us not forget the lonely and those down on their luck.
For as long as I'm warm and well fed, I couldn't give it. Tosh.
May they all be filled with Jesus' love and with his wonder struck. How about this? Merry Christmas, neighbours. Festive goodwill to you. I dearly hope this next year...
your dog will stop crapping on our lawn.
We'll bring you joy all through. In fact, how about this one? Baubles, candles, tinsel, lights. A festive time full of delights. Pretty garlands, a stunning wreath, a twinkling tree with presents beneath, roasted turkey, Brussels sprouts.
Oh, and we need milk.
It's actually the new year in, the old one out, so come on, let the magic start, let Christmas stay within your heart. All right, how about this one? Let it sparkle, let it shine.
Yes, yes, now put it away.
It's bring it on, it's Christmas time. And finally, as Mother stuffs the turkey and Father pours the wine...
Uncle Jack is shooting up and Grandma's done a line.
It really is a special treat when their two skills combine. Oh, there you are.
The worrying thing is I am actually somebody's grandmother, it's really...
Well, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there is just time to fit in a quick round of Manly Songbook. Sven's been telling us all about how he took part in his first rodeo after a helpful Texan cowboy offered him some guidance. Sven says it took just 6 seconds before he was tossed off and he hadn't even entered the ring. In this round, teams, I'd like you, please, to suggest titles of songs likely to prove popular with men. So, you better start this one, Sandy.
Stand by your mansplaining.
And Barry.
Hey, you, get off of my lawn.
Tim.
Everybody was man-flu fighting.
Graham.
I just can't get you out of my shed.
We shall overcome.
I see a red door and I want to paint it eventually.
My fart will go on.
Who took the bins out?
Knights on light statins.
I'm not bloody asking if this is the way to Amarillo.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the twinkling tinsel of time emerges from the Labrador's arse of eternity... and the bountiful bird of beneficence is blessed with the stuffing of a lifetime. I notice it's the end of the show, so from the teams, Sven, myself, and our audience here in Richmond, it's goodbye. Goodbye.
Barry Cryer, Graham Garden, Timbrook Taylor, and Sandy Toksvig will be given silly things to do by Jack D, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme consultants were Ian Pattinson and Fraser Steele, and the producer was John Naismith.